In this episode, I will set up a basic lathe using EtiCat, Linux CNC and a Raspberry Pi for CNC control, and I will show you how to do it. And here is where we will run the project today. I have this board, I don't know what material this is. Perhaps it is that famous aluminum I hear so much about. Anyways, it isn't so thick. But let's fix this raw surface. Before anything is done, let's answer the one and only question that is really important. What does it cost? It costs 450 euro, US dollar, Great Britain pound. They are all about equal, so there you have it. I have in mind to switch to EtiCat for my lathe. I use Linux CNC for my CNC system. So when searching for info on EtiCat and Linux CNC, one realized that there is a situation here. EtiCat is not officially supported nor included in Linux CNC. Not that it is technically difficult, no. The EtiCat licensing model and Linux CNC license, they are not compatible. Still, EtiCat has been used in Linux CNC for many years, so it is definitely not a new thing. The difficulty lies in finding info on how to use EtiCat, what software needs to be installed, and what changes are needed to HAL files, and so on. I have spent hour after hour looking through page after page of forum posts and eventually found my way. I thought that if I could manage to set up a minimal EtiCat system in Linux CNC and it could be done in a clean way, then I can do this video to share one way to set it up that at least gets you a starting point and perhaps some understanding on what is involved to have a small lathe using EtiCat devices. While we are waiting for the wiring to be completed, I can try to answer, what is EtiCat? It is a way to use a 100 megabit per second network for automation and motion control. There is an EtiCat master, that is the Raspberry Pi in this setup, that controls a number of EtiCat slaves. EtiCat slaves can be more intelligent or can take more advanced commands, like we will see stepper drives with closed loop control and a lot of parameters that can be controlled. There are also built-in things that make EtiCat suitable for motion control, like expecting update of data every millisecond, so 1 kHz. There is a way to synchronize the time between all devices, and there are more such things, all with the purpose to be suitable for automation and control. There are other ways to answer what EtiCat is. For my purposes, it is a way to control I/O devices and drives in Linux CNC. And all those details, you know, well, I hope they are all built in and I don't need to worry too much about them. Yeah, so then the wiring is done. So what we have here, it's a power switch. And in series with that, that is an emergency switch, so that one breaks the incoming power for everything here. This one is an emergency switch for Linux CNC, so that goes to one of the inputs over here. And the Linux CNC will react on that. Here are some terminals just to distribute cables, powers, and the 24 volt DC. The Raspberry Pi is powered by 5 volt DC. From this one onto the GPIO header. It's not a GPIO header, but there is a 5 volt and ground that can be used for powering instead of the USB-C contact. And on the EtiCat side, this is not an EtiCat side, this is just a power supply, 24 volt power supply that powers this unit stepper driver. And this is the first EtiCat device. It has 8 inputs and an encoder interface for a spindle interface. I will not use it, but I have it here anyways. And 2 stepper drivers. And 2 motors. One motor here is just a simple 3D printed motor. Without any encoder or anything. So it is just connected to the coils on that one. But the other one, that is one of my motors that are left over from my milling machine. So it's a closed loop motor. It has encoder. And here are the encoder inputs. And there is really a too stiff cable here, but anyways, that is what it is now. So 24 volts I will run this one. This one is run, I run this on 60 volts normally, but it works also on 24 volt. That's it. Okay, getting ready for the first startup. I have the right software on the SD card. I have a keyboard. I have a display. So, let's go. And now, let's see. Oh, things didn't break! Okay, we have things going on the screen there. So, now there are some softwares that need to be installed. Is it even possible to make a watchable video where all I say is watch this and that for details? Because that is what I will tell you. Watch a certain forum post at Linux and CF forum for details. Now you guess where you can find that link. And if you can't be bothered to watch the description, then test to search for Ethercat Notes Linux and CF. At least for me, the results take me to the right place. I have started with an image prepared for Linux and C. Well, it is just normal Raspbian with Linux C and all those packages. Plus the right real-time kernel, and that is already installed then. Just follow the normal procedures to connect to the Wi-Fi. Not via cable, because we are going to need the Ethernet port exclusively for Ethercat. Update packages to the latest and greatest in the usual way. There is nothing special to do up to this point. And when all installation things have settled down, the Raspberry Pi is ready to run Linux C. Just type Linux and C and off we go. But we are not going to do that just yet. To get the Ethercat function, there are two softwares needed and I will proceed to install them in the background. Check the forum post for details there. while I try to distract you with some other details. First, the two softwares that are needed, they are Etherlab and Linux and C Ethercat drivers. Etherlab is a software that turns the Raspberry Pi into an Ethercat master. The Etherlab software is a general software with APIs for access from programming languages as well as for use in MATLAB and Simulink. Etherlab was developed by, well, I don't have to say it.
Ingenieurgemeinschaft IGH.
Now, Etherlab is available from a few GitHub sources and I have tested more than one. Typically, they work in Intel Debian, but not on the Pi. The GitHub source I point to in that forum post works well, as you can see in the background. It doesn't take long to install the software, and when it's all done, better safe than sorry, please reboot. The Pi is now an Ethercat master. You have got a new command, Ethercat. Yes, that is what it is called of all names. Now, let's connect up the Ethercat slaves. It is mandatory to use yellow network cables. This is a bit cute. There is an input and an output, and I don't know what happens if you connect it the wrong way, but you are on your own if you do that. As I said, the Pi's network port is now dedicated to Ethercat. Well, you can always try to hook it up to your home network. I haven't, and I just assume it will not work. We are more than halfway now. The Pi is an Ethercat master. We now need a way to access the Ethercat master from Linux and C. That is the other software that is needed. Linux and C Ethercat driver, LCEC. That forum post says how to download, build and install that software. It should be a breeze. Unfortunately, there is a bit more talking because we want to make the Ethercat devices I have work like in a lathe. It will not be in a real lathe, it will be on this aluminum board in this episode. I will go slowly and take it in three steps, gradually building up the crescendo at the end. First, I'm going to check that Ethercat works at all. For this, I will use no clients, no hardware. The second check is to see that rudimentary functions like reading an input and setting an output works. And finally, hooking up the stepper motor drivers and simulate a lathe. The base configuration for this first test will be one of Linux and C lathe configuration that comes with Linux and C. Even if you don't have any Ethercat clients, you can repeat this step yourself. So start Linux CNC, select SIM, AXIS. Yes, we want to save a copy of the config, because we are going to modify it. There will be three modifications. A small modification to the ini file, and there will be a new HAL file, and an XML file, and that one is totally new, but I will show you. Go and find the lathe.ini file that was just copied. In that file, find the HAL section, add as last line HAL file equal to ethercat.hal. This will make Linux sincere read in the HAL file ethercat.hal. We need to create that one in the next step. This is what needs to go into the ethercat.hal file. Only four lines. Well, the first line loads the configuration file, that XML file I mentioned before. We will come to that one. Next line loads the actual Linux Sense Ethercat device and add the read all and write all functions to the servo thread. And here is a new thing we have never really bothered about before, in which order things are added to the servo thread, have we? I had not. Here it is suddenly important. The lcc.read-all must be added very early. It must be added before any updates to motion calculations. Likewise, the lcec.write-all must be among the latest to be added to the servo thread. So I say this already now with the order of the servo thread, because it is wrong to do it the way I do here. But for the first steps, when just checking for devices, this has no practical meaning. But keep it in mind and see if I do it the right way in the third step with the stepper drivers. Where are we? Yes, I have made the HAL file ethercat.hal. Now I need to do that XML config file, which I have called ethercat-conf.xml. So it seems I'm adding one ethercat master here, index 0. What the other parameters mean, I can only guess. The file came like that and it works fine, so yeah. Now it is ready to run. Start Linux and see. I will not do anything inside Linux and see, I will just start it. Search for that LCEC device. Yes, it is here. There are some entries and by that I think it works. There are no physical devices needed up to this point. So if you want to get a feel for ethercat, well, just try it. For the next step, I will use physical devices. I have a few backoff devices. I have a device with 8 inputs, a device with 8 outputs, and a device that is an encoder counter, that is for the spindle encoder. And there is some EK1100 which seems to be needed. So, of the three files I were into for the initial test, those three files I just modified, I now need to change the ethercat-conf.xml to reflect the clients I have. I have for the moment disconnected the stepper drivers. The type there, many of the backoff devices are predefined, and that single line is all that is needed to make it work. Save the new ethercat-conf.xml file and start Linux Sense again. Use the HAL show tool to follow the status of the digital input that is connected to the e-stop switch. Yeah, that works. I also tested that the digital output changed between 24 volt and 0 volt when modifying the HAL pin. Okay, the third step now. Include stepper drives and turn it into a lathe on this aluminum board. Let's go to yet another forum post and download the files needed, the inner file, the HAL file and the ethercat config file. Let's just check that ethercat config file. There are quite a few lines now, but most lines are copied and pasted, and the only lines I feel I am the author of are the lines to set max current and closed loop or open loop mode. Oh, I forgot. I use a component, CIA402, for the drives. Download and install. I will not say anything of all that can be said about CIA402. We want to see it run, right? I wonder what they thought here. A lathe? and turning that path, well, original at best. It works. Do you think I would make a video where it failed? No, don't answer that one. I'm quiet because there is really so much to say, but I don't want to ruin the good feeling going on and on with explanations. I will be very short. The HAL file. Yes, I remember the order of read all and write all. The CIA 402 components is connected to the joint on one end and to the LCEC on the other end. These lines are copied and pasted from the CIA 402 components, so no original work there either. You typically want to use CSP mode, cyclic synchronous position mode, or in other words, repeatedly updates of synchronous positions. Okay, some final words then. Let's bring up the etiquette config file again. PDO, fast data objects, are data that can be updated every millisecond. SDO, slow data objects, are settings to set once or seldom, at least not every millisecond. You can list the PDOs and SDOs using the etiquette command. But to know which value to set, you need a manual. CIA 402 devices are heavily standardized, but for things like the max current setting and open closed loop mode, you need a manual. There is a software, TwinCat 2, but I cannot see that it adds anything. Besides, we don't get along too well. I mean, it doesn't click between us. You can read and write data from an EtherCAT client using these commands. Vendor ID, product code and more info can be gotten from the drive using this command. I have found used backoff IO devices on the German eBay. There are plenty of used ones for sale. For stepper motor drives, make sure it follows the CIA 402 standard and that you can get a manual. It isn't enough with the XML file. Well, that's another XML file. We will not go there. The CIA 402 standard makes stepper drives and servo drives pretty much one-to-one replaceable. Had it not been for those device-specific settings, that seems inevitable. Those yellow Ethernet cables, they are just normal Ethernet cables. About the cost. Had it not been for the steep price of the etiquette encoder device, the etiquette setup would have come out cheaper than a traditional Mesa setup with old-fashioned stepper motor drives. What has been demonstrated here also works for Intel computers, but there are some settings needed for the Etherlab software, so best to go to the source there for info on how to build. In principle, the same anyways. Anyways, I now have the skeleton to drive the lathe. At some point I will move the stuff from the DIN rail here on the aluminum board and put that in a control cabinet. I can't believe you stay till the end. A big thank you to all LinuxNC developers and the LinuxNC community, without whom nothing of this would be possible. Thanks, guys.